Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. My name's Bruce, the part-time prospector, and I want to show you how I find potential gold prospecting locations in Western Australia using information that's available on this website. Now this website is not publicly available at the moment. It will be very soon. This is my own creation. But the same sort of techniques can be applied when using GeoView, TenGraph, Trilobite, DetectorMaps, etc., etc. Some of them have all the data sets, some of them have some of the data sets, some have only very few. The reason I've come up with my own is this has actually got all the data sets that I like to use in a way that I have. So here we are starting with a map of Western Australia. Perth's down here, for those that are not familiar, currently where I live. So the first thing you want to do here is that this is the steps that I go through. Doesn't mean that you have to. This is the steps that I go through. On the menu on the side, I turn on the soil samples and it helps to click on it. And this is the location of soil sampling across the state. So as you zoom in, and I'll just choose any random spot, it's black at the zoomed out levels. And as you go in, it actually turns into sort of colors. And as you zoom in more, you can actually see that there's some sampling taking place. The legend on the side here will actually tell you the colors. So the purples are greater than basically 100 ppb, basically the old 0.1 ppm grams per ton. So this is actually looking something quite significant in there. Obviously, there's some mines around there. So we'll zoom out a bit. That is the locations of where every one of those dots is giving you a potential to find a gold prospecting location. So what we want to look for is a string of highly anomalous soil samples indicating the position of a mineralized system that's on public land, or as a land that you're free to go on, not tied up with any other restrictions. And that is what we're looking for. And there are many other indicators that go with it. So let's jump straight in. So we've got the soil samples and let's go back to layers. So we start to look around the area. Now, one of the things, I'll go back a step. Okay, so just because we've got the whole state here, obviously there's many places here we cannot go because of it's either freehold land. It's ground that's already under a mining lease. It's ground that is national parks, protected Aboriginal heritage, special use lands, and you name it. There's a bunch of legislative areas that we cannot go. So just changing base views, and this is the standard Google base map. And this actually shows it quite well. Pretty much this line, as you can see with the cursor running along here, is the divider between the Southwest Ag Zone, which is all this area in here, which is predominantly the farms and most of the population of Western Australia crammed in this corner. The vast majority of that ground inside there is freehold land. Okay, so you're going to have to get written permission from the land holder to access any of their ground to even start prospecting. And that generally is very hard to obtain. Anything outside of this line, I'll rephrase it, except for the areas around towns and a few other gazetted areas, is crown land. So we go back to our map, places around, for example, zooming in, you've got Southern Cross. There's obviously a bunch of freehold land around there, so stay away from that. Same as around Kalgoorlie, Geraldton, whatever like that. So stay away from them. So now that we've got our maps, we know one category of land we're not allowed to go on. Next land category we're not allowed to go on is, as I mentioned beforehand, was the Aboriginal heritage, sorry, the Indigenous protected lands. And this is areas marked out here. So this is the polygon zones with ashing on it. And so they are basically a no-go without some sort of special permission. I think for just part-time prospecting, it's probably not worth the effort. If you're a mining company or a full-time prospector, it's probably worth the go. Aboriginal heritage areas. there's pretty much just these blue areas. There's a big area up here, and there's a lot of speckled areas around. Again, stay out of those. DMIRS Section 19 land is any land that DMIRS deems unacceptable to go into to do any prospecting or mining in, or staking leases over. There could be special use lands, whole bunch of different usages. Again, they stay out of those grounds. So now we're narrowing those down. Then we've got the legislated lands. Sure, that's a hard one to say. This is pretty much your national parks, nature reserves, etc. So that sits in those things on the green. So that cuts out. It can't go in those ones. So now that we've got those out of the way, those are the sort of the big areas, if you want to put it. Those are the sort of government controlled areas. Then we can say these are the areas that we cannot go on. Again, is the live tenements. Okay, so all the stuff drawn in green there, the sort of the squiggly bits, they are live tenements, which you cannot go on. Okay, so pretty much, apart from the freehold land, which this map doesn't show, and it's pretty hard to get hold of the freehold data, is you're allowed to go on. Okay, so all these little bits in here and here and here and here and here, you're allowed to go on. Okay. So now that I've got that information, and let's say I'm only going to constrain myself to the bottom half of the state sort of thing. So now I turn on to the soil samples. Oops, I already had turned on. Okay, there we go. Now that's the soil samples. Now, this is the tedious, time-consuming process. So looking at it straight away, I've ruled out looking at those samples. I'm not going to waste my time, same as these. There's soil samples crossing these green areas. Rule them out. Anything basic down here, rule them out. These areas here, rule them out. This is the time-consuming component of this process. And that is going through and looking individually at almost every band of samples, for want of a better word, looking for high values. So if we start zooming in, and I'm just going in the middle of the map. Okay, as you can see now, the data is starting to become clear. So what we're looking for is some reds, greens, and purples that are outside of the hashed areas here. So for example, if we zoom in here, you can see all that sampling occurs inside the lava lease. So you have to pan across and look around. There's some sampling outside of a lease out here, but it's got no real values in it. And you just keep looking around and around. Now you get these areas here which have been absolutely hammered for whatever reason. Now that looks interesting. Okay, just on that zone here. So let's have a look here. Now that, okay, that spans, it was hidden under those leases. So all that information there, the good stuff, is sitting in those leases over there. So that's ruled out. So we keep panning around. Now, so this is a time-consuming process, and you can burn many hours. This is a great process to use over summer when you can't go prospecting or it's pouring with rain or whatever reason, and you've got some time to kill and you're looking for places to go sampling. Now, there's an interesting spot there. You can see how there's a trend of samples running up there because there's the samples are running this way, but the colors indicate that something is running this way. And I'll show you how to just take it to the next level. Now, would this be worthwhile going to? It's probably, if you're in the area, I'd definitely go and have a look at it. But what I will do is I'll show you a particular location that I found in a previous search. And then what I will do is I'll give you the coordinates in the video later on, that if you want to go out and visit yourself, go for it. So let me grab the samples here. Okay, so this is a location, some of you might even know the location already. So this is what caught my eye. There's this sampling here, and then the sampling, there's a look down here. So why was this special? I guess there's some high grades interspersed with some low grades and nothing too special. But one of the things that, and down here, there's a good cluster of samples, wait for the computer to catch up, and we might just try and turn the base map to a lighter color. So you can see that there's definitely something winding its way through here. And if we turn on the Google base map and zoom in, there's obviously a line of workings running up through here, which this is following along nicely. Where's my samples going to? I'll turn them back on again. So it's following along closely along there. So it's interesting. Okay, now this is the techniques that I want to show you to do next. Is one is to go into the menus and you're looking for structures, faults, and shear zones. Now, as I've mentioned in a previous video, gold is only deposited in an area, and I'm talking about hard rock gold. It only comes up following existing faults and shear zones. These are cracks in the ground which the fluids have come bubbling up through and precipitated out into the quartz host rock, for example, where it was hosting the gold mineralization at the time. So the gold mineralization will almost always, with a few exceptions, almost always follow the direction of the prevailing faults in the area. Now, West Australia's been an old continent, and so it's been busted up many times. And so there's faults going all sorts of directions. But there's some major faults that go for tens of kilometers, sometimes hundreds of kilometers, if not more, across the continent. Now, the longer the fault is, the deeper down it goes. And the deeper down it goes, the more likely it's bringing up fluids from deep in the crust. So we're not interested in the tiny little faults, we're interested in the big faults. So if we go into here and turn on the faults. So this is the faults in the area. Now, it's interesting how this spur of the fault coming up here, they've sampled it and got some very good grades out of it. And this is, these faults come up here and actually follow the line of these workings through here. And so does this mean this is the exact location of the fault, or is it an estimate of the fault's position? It's the latter. It's the estimate of the fault's position. And a fault, vast majority of the time, is not just a single crack in the ground, like the classic thing in the movies, just a big crack in the ground and that's it, nothing around. What this the zone is, pretty much from anywhere from out here somewhere to anywhere out here, is a massive zone of faults. Because as you can see by the number of lines, this is an area that has been busted up more than once. And as the pressure comes on and off this area, the rocks are sheared and sheared and sheared and sheared and sheared and broken. So as the rock breaks, it's a zone of weakness. If more pressure is applied, it'll generally break on the same fault again. But if fluids have come up that fault and then deposited quartz and everything else inside them, and depending on the orientation, it could again snap at the quartz vein, usually at the boundary between the quartz and the country rock, it'll snap again, or it may snap parallel to it. So you get a whole bunch of parallel faults. Sometimes they can be down at the microscopic scale or to like the tens of hundreds of meters spacing between them. And so you end up with almost like it's really not a fault. It's almost like a shear zone of lots of faults. Some of them are going to be mineralized. Some of them are not mineralized. And some of them are going to be easily discernible on geological maps and drilling and everything else. And others are going to be much harder. So these blue lines are the representations of the easily identifiable faults that are from magnetics, which is one of these, where is it now? Something like that. If you put on the geophys, it can. There's the geophysics. And so you can start to see how they discern the faults. Now, they were mapped at quite a coarse scale, about 1 to 250,000, which basically means that 1 centimeter on the map is equal to 250,000 centimeters on the ground. This is what? How many centimeters is that? 25 kilometers? Like that? I don't know. Can't do the maths. And so you can actually start to see how they picked up some of these faults. Now, if you look inside here, you can actually see what looks like lots of other faults running through here. And so there's quite a few faults running around. So because of these faults, and there's a big zone of faults, and because the faults generally follow this trend of mineralization up through here, and there's looks like old existing workings running along here, there's some there down here, then I would say this area is definitely worth a visit. And so this is how you would actually start to chase up the samples. And one of the other options you can do is turn on the drill holes to see, did they think whoever owned this land beforehand and whoever did the sampling, did they think it was worthwhile? And you can see they've gone down here and put some drilling into these samples here, into sample locations to see if there's anything worthwhile. So what I would do, I would start to concentrate on this area down here. Obviously, it's the cluster of most of our samples. It has got drilling precedents. It's got some old workings. It's got faults. It's got everything that lines up together with it. So where are we in this sort of grand scheme of things here? And you can see that there's some definitely high mineralization, and it looks like it even continues down here. So this is looking like this one maybe, though maybe interpret up here, there could be actually a spur fault that comes off and runs up through here. And that could be mineralized as well. So if you look around the area, there's quite a few sample points. I'm going to turn off the drilling, a little bit confusing. And there's a little peep up here. So let's just jump to this map. And so you can see where it is. And I will turn off some of the these locations. So what we've got here, we've got sandstone up here, down here. So this is an interesting area with lots of sampling. One more look up here. Yeah, I thought that might be an exciting one, but that's gone. But there's definitely something happening around this zone here. So it's definitely worth a visit. It'd be nice if you could get into this to see what happens. But it was just saying, look, we turn on the structures. Maybe that continues up here. So it might be worthwhile looking along here. They've done a search out here, so maybe even doing some sampling out here. But sampling, some detecting, a couple of traverses, walking across, seeing what you can find. We might be actually quite surprised. So I hope that helps, guys. This is how I will go through the process and keep dropping a pin on these sample points until you end up with a big collection of pins, and then you can store them away and do what exactly what I did, just drag on the pins, drop them on, and away you go.